At the left-hand side, you see the building where we, one of the buildings on our campus. Unfortunately, I didn't feel completely well the last few days, so I'm currently at home in my hometown, Utrecht. And here in the second picture from the left, you see the Dom Tower that my city is famous for. So if you ever visit us in Wageningen, also be sure to have a look at Utrecht in the middle of the Netherlands. And one unfortunate thing is that I will not be able to join in the round table for that reason. So, but I'm still happy to be giving this this lecture here today. I want to start by acknowledging a couple of people, some of my collaborators from Wageningen University, but in particular the three PhDs that did some of the work that I will show in this lecture. The idea of this lecture is that I will give some general overview of how machine learning is applied on plant omics data, but I will use some specific examples from my own group to give a bit more detail. And that is work done by Janani, Sefking, and Muhammad. All right, so let me also briefly talk about my background. I think it was already nicely introduced, but just to give a bit more, to briefly summarize this, I did my PhD in structural biology, and you will see at some moment in this talk that now is also a very good time to think of using protein structures in machine learning, but I will get back to that later. And then currently I would maybe use the phrase plant system biology to summarize my my research, but this really is mainly using machine learning on plant data. A lot of it is on Arabidopsis, but we're also moving more towards applications in various crop species. And here on the map, I'm showing where I'm actually located. So this small dot here is Wageningen, and here again is one of our buildings. So let me move to kind of an overview of what this talk is about. And that is that when we talk about plants and omics data, we have really a lot of data at various scales available these days. So there have been a lot of improvements in measurement technologies, which result in the availability of data at various scales. And this is a picture that I took from a review that we wrote last year. I have references to the, I have a reference list at the end of this set of slides. So this you can maybe look at later if you want. But so this picture visualizes this data that we have at many different scales. So it ranges from the genotype and the genome level via biochemical levels of transcriptomics and metabolomics to data at the scale of plants or even larger scales. And the thing is that if we want to learn from the data, we will need to use computation to somehow connect the data and try to understand the meaning of the data. And there are, of course, different ways to do that. And very broadly speaking, you could think that on one end, you can use more mechanistic approaches to try and model data. And that is great if you can do it. But the point is that for a lot of this data, we and for a lot of these systems, we don't have sufficient understanding to make mechanistic models. And then very often machine learning can be useful, because what machine learning involves is finding patterns in data. And these patterns you can then also use to make connections between different types of data. So I would say that given the great increase in the amount of available data, and then the need to integrate and connect this data, that is one of the key reasons why machine learning is getting a lot of attention these days in order to make sense of this type of data. Now, in this picture, I give a bit more detail about these different data types. I will not discuss them now in detail. I think many of you have a lot of knowledge about this. So we can think of data using sequencing, think of data obtained using mass spectrometry, but this visualizes a bit the type of omics data that that we typically work with when we apply machine learning in on plant omics data. And here at the bottom, you see kind of an overview of how you can maybe categorize the different applications of machine learning on this type of data. And this is also a little bit the flow of this lecture today. So I will talk first about using machine learning more at the level of genomic regions. So can we understand or predict properties of genome regions? And then I will talk about other type of machine learning where we more focus on genes and how these are regulated or what their functions are. And after that, I will also talk about some more recent, very interesting developments in new developments in the use of machine learning on plant omics data. All right, so we first start now on the use of machine learning to analyze or predict properties of genome regions. And you can think here of various things that you might want to do. Some of these are very classical tasks, like annotating genomes, and people have done that in various ways. But one thing that you these days really can do is to use machine learning to annotate genomes. And what that would involve is that you need to have examples, because this is a typical thing with machine learning. You need examples of what you want to predict, and then you can learn to predict new things. So that would be one thing on the level of genome regions. You can also think of predicting which genes are active versus pseudogenes. There are applications at the population genetic level. I show a picture here of what that looks like. So it involves predicting using, for example, resequencing data from a population, predicting where selective sweeps took place. But I want to give a specific example for my own research, which involves the prediction of crossovers. So we'll talk a bit more in detail to use that as an example of how we can do machine learning at the genome region level. So, the idea here is that we want to predict crossovers. So this involves the regions in the DNA where the paternal and the maternal DNA, where you have a switch between paternal and maternal DNA. So I visualize here very schematically how that happens during meiosis. So in blue and red, we have the paternal and maternal chromosomes. And then, I'm not going into here, but the effect of the meiosis is that you get this mixing and matching between these two types of DNA. And this is, of course, a very essential process. It is of key relevance for evolution, and it generates diversity. So it's very interesting to study from a more fundamental perspective, but also for breeding application. Of course, crossovers are key. So there's been quite a lot of studies where people experimentally investigate where crossovers take place. And the point here is that these crossovers don't take place at random positions in the genome, but you can really find certain patterns. At the same time, we don't understand sufficiently well how these patterns are generated, or what exactly determines the preference for crossovers to occur in certain location, not in another location. So for these reasons, we thought it would be could be very useful to try and use machine learning to predict crossover locations. And I'm showing here two examples of training data that we had available. So these are large-scale data sets where people in a certain, based on a certain cross, they investigated the occurrence of crossover. So here we have the different chromosomes, for example, of Arabidopsis or tomato, and then the bars here indicate the number of crossovers. But underlying that is that we also know the exact locations of these crossovers, or to a certain extent, we know their exact location. I don't show it here, but this gives an idea of the data that we have available. So our goal was then to use machine learning to predict where in the genome these crossovers are likely to occur. And I would like first now to consider why this is a machine learning, how you can frame this as a machine learning problem. And in particular, we framed it as a so-called classification problem. So classification means that we try and predict multiple different classes based on some properties of the data. So classification is one of the main main examples of or main tasks in machine learning. And here at the top left, I visualize in a very schematic way what classification is about. So here we have red and black circles, and in this very simple classification example, our task would be to predict whether a circle is black or red based on the position of these circles, so based on x1 or x2. And x1 and x2 would be, here would be the position. But in our DNA-based model, it would be some numbers that somehow represent the DNA. And we'll talk in a minute about how we can do that. But this is the technical term here is features. And it's good to realize that, of course, here in this simple example, we just have two features. But in realistic examples, you would have many of these features. You would have many numbers that somehow characterize your input data. And so to map this example, this toy example to the crossover prediction, you need to think that maybe the black circles are locations in the genome where we experimentally found crossover, and then the red would be positions in the DNA where experimentally we did not find crossovers. This last point is a little bit tricky because, of course, if there was no crossover measured, it doesn't mean that the crossover cannot occur there. So we did some work to decide how exactly to sample these negative regions, but I will not talk about it now in detail. You can read that in the paper if you're interested. And this is actually also an example of something that happens quite often in this type of machine learning on omics data, is that you maybe have a set of positive measurements, but for your negative measurements, so the examples from the other class, might be more difficult to get these. Anyway, I talked about how we can frame the crossover prediction, so predicting properties of genomic region, in this case, whether they are crossover sites or not, how we can frame that as a classification problem. And now I want to explain how we can indeed convert genome sequence to numeric inputs, so these so-called features. And there are different ways that you can think of. In some approaches, people maybe count the occurrence of certain k-mers, and you can think of many different things. In our case, we used a combination of multiple things. We looked at sequence variation, and then the absence or presence of certain variation would be a number. We looked at the occurrence of transposons in the DNA, and again, the absence or presence of certain transposons would be a number. We also looked at the occurrence of dinucleotides. So this, again, gives you a number, how much of these dinucleotides occur or not in a certain genome region. And we also used an approach which predicts the kind of the three-dimensional structure of the DNA, and that again is a set of numbers that we can use to characterize that a given genome region. So then we use this training data that I showed before, and on this slide I summarize a bit what the model performance was. I can imagine that not all of you are familiar with this kind of plot, so let me briefly talk about it. We have here a visualization of the false positive rate and the true positive rate. These are two different numbers that tell you how good is the model. And then depending on some cutoffs in the model, we get different false positive rate and different true positive rate. So this curve characterizes the performance of the whole model. And the more to the top left this curve is, the better the prediction. So these three different colors here indicate three different machine learning models. A decision tree in green, a logistic regression model, and a random forest. And you can see here that the random forest model worked best in this case. Now, in addition to the prediction itself, which has quite decent performance, I would say, but in addition, we also looked at how does the model make its prediction. And this is one key thing that I want to stress here today, is that in some cases, when people use machine learning, they are maybe not so interested in why does the models make a certain prediction. Maybe you only want to predict something. That can be the case. But I think in the application of machine learning to omics data in plants, you would often also try and use the model to learn more about your system. And one way in which you can do that is to, like we show here at the right-hand side, is to look a bit at which features are really important for the model to make the prediction. And I think in view of time, we will not discuss this now in detail, how does this work, but what the plot shows is like the top most important features. So this gives you some feeling about what the model really found important. And in particular, at the top, at the left-hand side, there's propeller twist and helical twist, and these are two aspects related to the DNA structure. And that was quite an interesting finding, that somehow the model thought that the predicted DNA structure was really important for it to make the predictions. So I want to spend a little bit more time on this topic of the model interpretation, because as I said, I think it's often quite important in our field. And here I want to take it a bit to the extreme, in the sense that I want to stress that some machine learning models by their very nature are quite well open for interpretation. And I show an example here at the right hand side. This is a so-called decision tree. And this is a very simplistic example, of course, but this decision tree starts here at the top with the question, and then you can say yes or no, and then you follow the decisions, and then you get the answer. And so here the model is completely transparent. You don't need to do any effort. If you have trained this model on some data, then subsequently you can also understand how it makes its predictions. At the left-hand side, it's very different. We have a neural network, or so-called deep learning model, and there we have several layers, and can in reality be much more complex than what I show here. And there it's much more difficult to understand how the model makes its predictions. You can still do effort to get that, but the point is that there are differences between how easily you can interpret model behavior. And of course, it's also good to consider, why would we want to interpret a model? And I listed some reasons here, and I think that in our field, it's particularly relevant that model interpretation can help us to understand better our problem, because we can learn something about the system that we study. And also it can help to really define actions based on the model. And that would, in our case, involve, for example, designing new experiments. And maybe for the crossover model, that's not so clear, but I will soon talk about another example where you can indeed see that based on model interpretation, you can also think of specific experiments that you can design. And actually, this is kind of a summary of what I just said. So at the level of genome regions, the example with crossovers, there we can interpret the model and then think about what determines the position of crossovers. And actually, but this is a bit more in the future, you can also think of how you can use that knowledge for modifications in order to maybe engineer to get crossovers in positions that in a breeding scheme you normally cannot get them, something like that. I do think that an example that I will talk about in a few minutes, which is at the level of proteins or genes, there it's much even more clear that indeed model interpretation can help you to make new experiments, because if you think of protein function prediction, then if your model somehow tells you which residues are important for that function, then that obviously can allow you to make, for example, use mutagenesis experiment to understand more about, in this case, enzyme specificity. All right, I think it's indeed a good moment then to move forward to this second type of applications of machine learning. So we move now from the level of genome regions to the level of genes or gene products, so proteins. And here again, there's a variety of things that people do. You can think of, for example, predicting expression levels of genes based on promoter sequences. And one quite interesting example that I really would suggest you can study if you're interested is from this paper from a few years ago, where people made a couple of different models to predict expression levels. And in particular, what I found interesting there is that they used, that they combined data from multiple different plant species, I think included maybe Arabidopsis, mace, and maybe other species as well. I don't remember exactly, but I think this kind of using information from multiple different species and trying to learn patterns across species boundaries is something that is still quite at an initial stage in the application of machine learning to plant omics data. So I do think this kind of work is very promising. But okay, this is one example of work at the level of genes. You can also think of prediction of gene regulatory networks, and there are a lot of examples where people do that. So using maybe expression data and then predicting which genes regulate which other genes. I will not talk about this now, but this is really a big field, and it's obviously it's obviously quite important and useful if you can indeed predict regulatory networks. You can also think of predicting, this is a bit of a specific example, but you can think of using expression levels of genes to predict, for example, traits of plants, maybe stress response of other traits. QTL candidate gene purchase is also something that people do with machine learning. We did also some work in that direction. But I would like to briefly give a bit more detail about an example that I already briefly alluded to, which is the prediction of enzyme function. And this is work that we recently did on plant sesquiterpene synthesis. And I want here to discuss the most simple version of this predictor. We have also a more complicated version where we predict at more detail, but for this talk I will focus on the kind of predicting the first step in the production of sesquiterpenes, which is catalyzed by these enzymes. So they start, the sesquiterpene synthesis all start from FEP, and then they go through multiple different steps. But you can kind of categorize them based on the initial cyclization that takes place. So we have a couple of different, we have six different groups, basically. So this initial predictor focuses on predicting those classes. And you need to, what you need to know is that a typical plant has maybe dozens or even hundreds of different sesquiterpene synthesis, and then they all use the same substrate, but they all make different products. And these compounds are relevant for fragrance and other things, also defense sometimes. And they are also very useful in biotechnology applications. Well, I will not talk more about it now, but it's really, there are different applications. But I want to talk here about the machine learning. And one thing that you can, of course, wonder is, do we need machine learning? Because maybe if we just look at sequence similarity of these enzymes, maybe if we... maybe that already tells us enough, but in this phylogeny of a set of characterized plant sesquiterpene synthase, you can see that phylogeny itself does not give sufficient information about functions for these proteins. Because you can, so the different colors here indicate these six different groups that I just mentioned. And then you can see here examples where enzymes with the same color, so here's something in red and here's also something in red, they're very far apart in the phylogeny. And also you can see examples here at the top where we have all different colors very close to each other. So these are very similar sequences, but the enzymes still have different functions. So this visualizes that the prediction of the product that these enzymes make, you cannot do it by just making use of overall sequence similarity. Now, we again frame this as a classification problem, like in the crossover example. And then, of course, we again needed these features that I talked about before. So we somehow needed to convert the enzyme information to some numbers that our models can use. And in this case, we decided to use both sequence and also structure. Now, I will not talk much about how that worked, making these features, but... you can imagine that, like in the previous example, we can convert sequences to numerical representations, but then in addition we also generated structures for these modeled structures for these proteins, and we converted these to features as well. And I will say something, if I have time, I will say something about using structures in a minute in some other context. For now, I want to focus on the result of this exercise, and it was quite interesting to observe that indeed adding structure features compared to using only sequence features, it really improved the model, but that also depended on how we analyzed the performance of the model. So let me guide you through the through this table. We have here three different prediction approaches. One is based on overall sequence identity, so not really using machine learning. One is using machine learning with only sequence features, and then one is with machine learning including structure features. And in the lines here, we have three different ways at by which we looked at the performance of the models. One is by randomly splitting the data without making any effort to do anything else. And this is something that in some applications machine learning would be sufficient, would give you a good idea of the performance of your models. But we realized that in this case, we needed to do a bit more thinking, because we realized that if you just randomly split the sequences, so 80% to train your model and 20% to test it, then what you will get is that the model will, even based on sequence identity, will seem to work quite well, but that is primarily because there's a big bias in which sequences have been characterized. So there are many related enzymes from very close related species that have been analyzed, and although these are not always the same function, you also can see that still quite often they do. So by just, especially if they're very, very, very related, so by just splitting randomly a training and a test set, then the performance is really not very indicative of a practical application of this model, because in practical application, you would be more interested in very novel enzymes where you don't have very similar sequences. So we also made a performance assessment by using some genus to train the model and other genus to characterize the performance, and also by separately using only unicots to train the model and then monocots to characterize the performance of the model. And you can see that in particular in the last case, which is really the most difficult kind of case, you see that using the machine learning model gives much better performance. So the number here is the accuracy. So you can interpret this like 75% is correct, and here it's only 50% with using the sequence identity. So here we really see the importance of using structure features, and also that, of course, it depends on how you analyze your model performance. So this, I think, is good to keep in mind in general, actually. I would like to go briefly back to the point of model interpretation that I mentioned already. And because also this kind of model, where we have features at the sequence and structure level, we can really try and use approaches that tell us which parts of the protein are most important according to the model. And I'm showing some visualization here. Maybe you can ignore the right-hand side, but let's focus on the left-hand side. So this is an example of a protein structure from one of the plant sesquiterpene synthases. And then the colors here indicate which parts of the protein are important according to the model. You can see that many of these positions are close to the active site, which is here. And that makes sense, of course. But there are also some positions somewhat further away. But one very interesting opportunity, and this is something that we're currently working on, is that we can now use these positions to also not only validate the overall prediction performance of the model, that was on this previous slide, but to also look at, okay, if we now have these predicted positions, can we maybe change the function of some of these enzymes? So we're currently designing some test cases for that. And yeah, I cannot tell you the results yet, but maybe another time. The point here, though, is that that here again, you see an example of why model interpretation can be really useful. So I'd like to move on now. We talked so far about two types of applications of two very broad type of applications of machine learning on plant omics data, namely using machine learning at the level of genome regions and using machine learning at the level of genes or gene products. And something goes wrong here. I'm sorry. I would now. Sorry, am I still? I'm not sure what's happening here. Okay. Yeah, I'm back. Somehow something went wrong with my slides. I'm sorry, but I think I'm back now. So what I would like to do now in the next maybe 5 or 10 minutes or so is to talk about more recent developments in the application of machine learning on plant omics data, because I think there are some very exciting developments. They're also connected with technical developments in machine learning in general. So let me guide you a bit through that. And the first thing I want to mention here is that there's currently a big interest in connecting machine learning approaches with mechanistic models. I mentioned at the beginning of this lecture that we often use machine learning because we want to maybe integrate or connect data and learn from our data. But yeah, we cannot do this with mechanistic models often, because often we don't have them. But of course, there are also cases where we do have mechanistic models, maybe like models based on differential equations, for example. So for example, could be other things. But so if you have that kind of models already, but you also have much more data that does not fit so well with this type of mechanistic models, then it can be very interesting to think about combining machine learning with mechanistic models. And there are some different ways that people call this, and in particular I want to mention here is the physics inspired machine learning, or physics inspired neural networks, and the picture here kind of visualizes that. And this might be a bit scary if you don't like equations, but what it kind of visualizes is that the kind of neural network that is shown here at the left hand side can also be combined with a differential equation model that expresses some knowledge that you have about your system, and in particular you can combine that knowledge from a differential equation model, you can combine it in the loss function that you already define also for your neural network, so you can optimize these both things simultaneously. So you will then get a solution of your problem that is a good fit according to the neural network, but that also is in line with your mechanistic model. This type of approach is quite novel, and I don't think there's much examples of using it at plant level yet, but I'm sure this will change soon, and we're also ourselves working in that direction. So in particular, we are part of a new project that should start early next year, where we will apply this type of combination, this type of hybrid machine learning to predict stress resilience. And one example of the type of work that we will do there is visualized here in this slide, where we will make different modules to some machine learning modules that characterize aspects of plant behavior, and then we will combine that with existing models that tell you something about flowering time. And this we will initially develop in Arabidopsis, but in a later stage we will also work on this in a couple of different crop species. And I think this is really a very interesting development, this combination of machine learning with mechanistic models. A second recent development, it's not recent in the sense that, so a second recent development is the use of protein structures. Now, of course, protein structures are already available for quite some time, so people have also done machine learning on protein structures for a long time, but what really has changed very recently is that we can use much more protein structures as input, and this relates to the fact that there's this new AlphaFold prediction. So you can find at the EBI website, for example, you can find the predicted structures of millions of proteins. For example, for all of the proteins that are available in UniProt, you can now get a predicted structure of quite good quality in most cases. So this really opens up new opportunities of using protein structures as input for machine learning. I will not talk about examples here, but if you think back of the example that I just discussed on enzyme function, you can imagine that for that type of work, but also for many other applications of machine learning on omics data, using structures can be relevant. Can think of predicting of interactions, for example, and many other things. On this slide, I just want to visualize something more at the methodological level that we're working on ourselves in my group, which is that there's also really a need to work more on how can we represent structures as input. So this relates back to this point of the features that you make for your input cases. And there are really different ways that you can think of how to represent a protein as input for machine learning. And it might have really influence on your performance. But okay, let's move on. So the third recent development that I want to briefly discuss is that is so-called unsupervised analysis. The machine learning that I've talked so far about is mostly what we call supervised. Supervised means we have some example cases, for example, some proteins for which we know the function, and then we use those known cases to predict the function, to make a model that can predict the function of other cases. But you can also think of unsupervised analysis, where you don't want to predict a specific label of your cases, but you want to find more general patterns that somehow tell you something about your data. And examples would be clustering, for example, but also many other unsupervised analysis approaches exist, and actually these are in a very active development these days. And one area in which you can find really interesting applications of unsupervised analysis is single cell RNA sequencing. I think if you have time, I will not discuss now how single cell sequencing works. Just what you need to know for the next few slides, it's single cell sequencing means you get in principle expression levels of many different cells for many different genes for many different cells that you collected. And I want to briefly explain a little bit about what this unsupervised analysis of this type of data can involve. And in particular, I want to contrast it with the use of PCA, principal component analysis, that I think many of you will know about it. PCA is great, and you should definitely try it in general if you think it can help you. But it doesn't always work, and that relates to the fact that it's a linear approach. And so if there's patterns in your data that are not linear, then you will not find it. And also, the thing is that PCA really focuses on, let's say, the global structure in your data. So there have been quite active developments in alternative approaches that more focus on local structure. And one main idea in these approaches is that you will look at the distances between different data points, and then you try to find a way to represent your data in such a way that these distances, these local distances, are more conserved. So this is a very different underlying idea compared to PCA. Still, the output of these approaches, and one of them is what I show here, TSNE. The output, in a way, you can compare with what you get with PCA. Only the difference is that PCA is a linear technique, and then these newer approaches like TSNE or UMAP is another example. They are not linear. But here you see one example, and this is an example of a set of different images, and each color indicates a different type of image, and you can see here that PCA really cannot make a good representation of this data in two dimensions, whereas this TSNE approach very nicely shows different groups. Each color here is really separate from all other colors. And this is an example which is more relevant from, this single cell sequencing data, where we have, this is just one randomly chosen example of an Arabidopsis sample, where we have over 4,000 different cells that were analyzed, and then you can see that the application of TSNE really again separates all these, separates nicely related cell types. So it's a technique that can really help you to get insight into your data. Now, one other reason why this type of unsupervised analysis is also very relevant relates to what we call embeddings. And embeddings are ways of representing your input data. So you can think kind of like making features of your data. But these embeddings, they are made by analyzing large sets of available sequences, for example, or structures. And I show here some examples to papers where people present some examples of embeddings, one for the DNA level and one at the protein sequence level. And the thing here is that by using lots of available sequence data to make these embeddings, so this is again unsupervised, done in an unsupervised way, but by making use of that large amount of data, you can get a representation of your sequences that you can subsequently use in supervised machine learning. And often you will have a better representation than if you start from scratch. So it's really, in many applications has been shown that using this type of unsupervised based generated embeddings can really improve your prediction performance. Now, I think that I've only a few more things that I want to share with you. And one thing here is that I want to get back to this picture that I showed at the beginning, which was about different scales of data that we deal with. And I focused a bit on the genomic scale, but of course, there's much more than that. And you can really think about connecting genomes to traits. So I want to briefly talk about that. Basically, you can think of doing what is called genomic prediction, where you have a population for which you have genotypes and phenotypes. You use that to make a prediction model, and then for a population of interest, you can try and predict phenotypic values based on genotypes. Now, this is a very classical statistical problem, so there are many approaches that work quite well, but it's also under active development how we can use machine learning towards this end. And in particular, people are focusing a lot on using deep learning. I think if you have time, I will not discuss this example here in detail, but I want to mention that there are different ways in which people represent genome data as input for deep learning to do genomic prediction. And this is a recent model that I think had quite promising performance. So if you're interested in this type of application, then you could look at that in more detail. We're also planning to go in that direction, or we started to go in that direction ourselves. Yeah, what we so far have mainly been doing is to analyze a bit under which conditions more classical statistical approaches work well versus under which conditions machine learning based approaches for genomic prediction work well. So you see here some visualization of how performance on a test data, this is based on simulated data, how that depends on if you have a simple trait or complex traits, and then also how many samples you have. And what this basically shows, and this is also what you would expect, is that yeah, there's a clear effect, of course, of the number of samples. So if you go from left to right here, you see that with fewer samples, of course, your problem is more difficult. And also the trait type has an influence. But what this also showed quite interestingly is that there are some scenarios in which the more classical approaches really underperform compared to machine learning approach like a random forest in blue, or a boosting approach, which is kind of related to random forest. So this is very, it's kind of an initial investigation, but yeah, we really think it's an interesting area to continue with. One issue is that compared to some other applications of, in particular, deep learning, the number of training cases that is available is often not so large, at least not data that's available in the public domain. So this is something that we're still struggling with a little bit.
Dr. Alti? Do you have 5 minutes to finish your lecture? Is okay?
Yeah, this is very much okay, because actually I think this is my last slide, so maybe I will not
so
even
great.
Need. I will maybe not even need 5 minutes, but I will take my time to talk.
Okay,
about this.
Go ahead.
Yeah, thank you. Yeah, because this is actually one, but the last slide. The last slide is with the references, so I will not. I don't need to show that now. So I want to, briefly summarize what I talked about, and I want to say something about what I think are important directions for the future. So first, what I've been talking with you about is how we can apply machine learning to analyze plant omics data, and we have this application more at the level of genome regions, or we have the application more at the level of genes, and then I also talked about some recent developments. The use of unsupervised analysis and using protein structures as input, for example. One key thing that I want to again mention is that the interpretation of models is often quite important in our field. So this is not always the case in machine learning. In some other applications, when you have a self-driving car, for example, you really don't care why your model makes certain prediction, as long as it is correctly identifying people on the street and this kind of things. But for application on omics data, often you want to understand more about what the, why the model is making certain predictions. That being said, let me briefly talk about some future outlook. I think that one thing that you can see happening in, let's say, data science in general, but also in the plant sciences and data sets that are generated there, is that there's increasing awareness of making data better available and using standards to describe not only the data, but also the metadata. And I think this is something that will really also be beneficial for the application of machine learning, because there's so much data measured, but lots of what is published is not really usable, for example, if the experimental conditions are not well described. And I do see, although it's maybe going slowly, but I do see that there's a direction in the right movement where standards are increasingly seen as important. One other thing that I think will be very interesting to work on is the application of machine learning to less controlled environments, let's say on data from the field, for example. And this is something that I've not been involved with, but I've seen some other examples, and I think it's really, of course, this is key also towards application of machine learning in the context of breeding in the end. A third thing that I didn't have really time to talk about, but is very interesting, and also there's lots of development there, is that people also have more and more attention to what you can call unstructured data. So the examples that I gave of machine learning today are really structured in the sense that you have a set of cases and a set of features that you calculate. But there are also other examples and where the input data is less well structured. And one example here is that I give of something that we're looking at ourselves now is if you have some pictures and about the insect that moves on plant leaves. So you have this insect moving on different genotypes, and you have images measured for all these different genotypes of how the insect moves over this plant leaf. Then how do you use that kind of data as input, for example, for genomic prediction? And it's quite of an interesting direction to go towards. And one final thing I want to mention that I think is also related to model interpretation is the use of machine learning models to also make decisions. There are different types of machine learning that allow you to do that. Reinforcement learning is one of them. And this is not so often used yet in plant omics data analysis, but I do think there's this is also something that you can expect more in the future. So that being said, I think I want to finalize here. I want to thank you for your attention. It was really a pleasure to give this lecture. So thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Alti, for the excellent lecture. It is a lot of information of the great importance for the area. The use of machine learning in sequence, population genetics, active genes, among other that you mentioned, are great advances for the science. So for the participants, unfortunately, Dr. Alti will not be able to participate in the roundtable. As you saw that he has a flu, so if you have any question or curious about his talk, you can do this now. Let's see some question. We have some question for Dr. Out, the audience of the YouTube channel. We have from Jacqueline Schmidt, great lecture, Dr. Out. It is possible to include together data from different experiments, biochemical, genetic, morphological, to predict responses of a pathway acting in a given species.
Yeah, thanks for this question. I think it's an excellent point. So I didn't talk so much actually about this kind of data integration, but it's for sure something that people work on. One problem often will be that maybe your training data will be quite heterogeneous, so it might not be so easy to combine data because maybe the conditions were different from one experiment to the other. So you really need to think of ways to not just have the measurements themselves, but also somehow represent some features of the experimental conditions, let's say. So you can think of including some, let's say if temperatures were different or something. I'm just giving an example here, but you could think of including that type of information also as features in your machine learning model. So indeed, I think this is possible, but it's not so easy. Also because of the heterogeneity of the data, you maybe need quite some training examples. But it's something that makes a lot of sense. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you. Do you have more questions? So I think no. It is dark in your room. Yeah. It's night here in your city. Yeah.
I had not realized this, but indeed already the evening is starting here, and yeah.
Okay. So thank you so much, Dr. Alt, more time for accepting our invitation, and we wish you well, okay? And for the audience, if you have some doubt or some question, we can pass your contact for the people contact you.
Yeah, I would very much appreciate that. I'm very sorry that I cannot join the roundtable, but I think I better not do this. But I'm very interested. If you have questions, really feel free to contact me. No problem at all.
Okay. Yeah. Thank you so much.
Yeah. Okay. Bye-bye then.